make some, we're back at the budget here, another work session. We've had several work sessions. We haven't decided anything. So we have some new figures out in front of us now, some, a new proposal. So in those proposals, is everybody in the, this was, everybody got these from the board?
From Mike and Bryant? Those, is that the, those are the cuts we're talking about?
The proposed cuts, yes.
Yes.
And we're proposing a cut, just so everybody understands, we're proposing a cut in legislation, what's that word, Mike?
Legislated.
$14,000. Administration, $4,700. Economic Development, we're gonna cut $6,000, where it's proposed, not that we are. Community Development, they wanna, we wanna look at cutting $12,300 out of the budget. The Welcome Center, total there in, is $23,000, and that's gonna include some marketing and some cuts at the Welcome Center. And then our police budget, $7,600. So just so you folks know what's going on out there in the gallery, I don't know if you had one of these.
Don't forget page two.
Don't forget the park.
Oh, yeah, and the park, we're gonna cut $15,000 out of the parks budget up there, so.
I wanna just start with saying here that the reason this is brought up is because it's been repeatedly asked to have a solution if the other proposed original budget is a concern. So this is that. So this is just a response to, I guess, request, if you will. So, and then I just wanted to let that be known.
I'll say.
And without commenting on this, because I don't have a position, I do respect the work that went into it.
So do I.
Here, here.
I thank you all that went and did the due diligence, like I asked. You did what was asked of you, and I appreciate that. So with that, we're gonna do some public comments. I know we have some folks out here. You have some public comments to make?
Sorry, thank you, Susan. Thank you, ma'am. My luggage.
I'm Mickey Ketting, and I live on Jefferson. I'm a member of the Foundation for the Restoration of St. Genevieve. I'm a board member. And I know that there's this consideration to lower the budget, and we're right at a point that we need to at least keep it the same and maybe increase the budget. We're seeing more and more tourists coming down here. When the school tourists come down, we see them coming into through the house, and those have been getting more and more. But better than that, we're getting adult tours that are coming into town. And those people, once they have toured, they give them time to go and spend money. And it is not true. I've heard this in, you know, read the articles in the paper where it says only those people that have businesses downtown make any money off of tourists. The money that they make, they then go and spend in town. You know, once they come, they move to town, they have to live someplace. Maybe they rent a house for a little bit or rent an apartment, and eventually they buy a house. And once they bought the house, then they have to get their water heater clean, you know, tuned up, or they have to, you know, get some paint to paint the house. It trickles down. Everybody is to the benefit of those tourism dollars. It's not just those few people that have tourism dollars put directly into their hands. People then have money to go buy gasoline and go on a little road trip of their own, or stay in town and just do running back and forth in town. But when I see it, and it just makes me so mad every time it said, well, those people make tourism dollars and none of the rest of us do. When we owned the grocery store, we saw it all the time. All of those organizations that had festivals, Jour de Fête, all of that, people bought food and then they turned around and sold it to the tourists that came to town. It's everybody that benefits from those tourism dollars. If Jour de Fête wasn't successful, and that's purely a tourism event, then we would be having to support many of the school organizations much more closely, because they make almost all of their budget over Jour de Fête weekend. The sports teams make a lot of their budget from Jour de Fête weekend. you know, the sport boosters are out there, you know, selling beer and stuff, and that directly affects the school teams, and it trickles down. It goes, you know, other places. And it's much better to have them doing it to you all having to go out, and every time there is an event, you need to spend $25, $30, $50 to help support the kids in town. So you can thank not having to do that on the tourists that come to town. So you want to get more and more tourists here so they will spend their money so you don't have to spend your money. Let them come to town and buy gasoline so we keep our gas stations open. Let them come to town and support all the businesses in town so they don't move away because they're not getting anybody coming in and buying things. There's just not hardly anything in town that I can think of that doesn't get some of that tourism dollar. Maybe secondhand, maybe third hand, but it goes someplace. So think very hard before you cut that, because it is having an effect. The next few tours that I have on my calendar that are coming in are adults. Adults spend money. They do. So think very hard about that before you do that, because that would be detrimental to a lot of people, including maybe some of you if you own, have businesses and things. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else got anything to add to that or any other?
I'm Jack Ketting, and I live on Jefferson Street as well. I'm speaking on behalf of both the Tourism Tax Commission and the Tourism Advisory Council, and as a member of the Foundation for Restoration of St. Genevieve, I'd also like to say that I think that any kind of drastic cut in the tourism budget is going to be detrimental to the city. I was talking with Jan Brons, who owns in St. Genevieve Bay, and he said that it's really tough for them to make it now, and with this talk of anti-tourism, they're looking at just, you know, closing up. I mean, it's sad. I mean, we've got to keep the, and it's the one, or at least one aspect of city government that returns dollars, real dollars, and allows those dollars to turn over and over. And I just think that, I know it's a tough decision because you're looking at all departments, but I just feel that
Effort that the city has put forth to bring the national park here, one of the things that they looked at, of course, was what kind of system we have in place for bringing people into the area. So I thank you for your time this evening.
Good evening, I'm Bob Mueller. I live on Merchant Street. I understand the need that you all have to want to do more with roads and a lot of other things in the city of St. Genevieve. There's never enough. I spent my whole career in business. I mean, that's it. And most of my career was cutting costs sometimes, or a lot of it. But there was never enough resources to go around for everything we wanted to do. We had to set priorities. And I sat through some of your early budget meetings, and you talked about zero-based budgeting. Nobody seemed to be excited about that, but there was a discussion that was to be held about priorities. I don't think you ever held that. And that's unfortunate, because in business, you have to set priorities, and that's what you're doing kind of in your budget. But I would have liked to have heard what this body's priorities are. Well, when I was in business, we could increase revenues three different ways. We could raise prices on our products. Sometimes that didn't work quite so well, but we did it. We could cut cost, which is where I did a lot of. or we could increase sales. And I think the same thing has to do with a governmental body. You have similar kinds of things. You increase your sales price by increasing your tax rates. That's not a very popular thing anymore. You can cut cost. It's not something that's inherent to governmental bodies that I've seen in my whole career. But, and I'm not going to say anything bad about the people that are in our government, because I'm very impressed with all of them. They work hard. Some of them are good friends. I appreciate what they do. But you do have to look at ways to become more efficient. And you have to find ways based on your priorities where you're going to put your dollars, what you have. But I think what's the most important thing that we ought to consider is how are we going to increase sales? How are we going to get more? Without increasing the tax rate, if we just increase the amount of sales going on in this town, you're going to have more revenue for roads, for other things. And it's not going to be as detrimentally looked at as raising taxes. I looked at your revenues for last year. In the city of St. Genevieve, you had $6.178 million of revenue. Some of that revenue was transferred in from the levy tax capital program. Some of it was some other reserves got transferred in. So that really wasn't revenue generated. It was generated in the past. So about $500,000 of that $6.2 million came out. And I looked and I said, what's left? And in business, when we looked at cost, we always looked at what's driving that cost. So I looked at what drives your revenue. And there's about, I think it's about $5.7 million of revenue that isn't those transfers in. And when you look at that, 41% of that is water and sewer. You got a monopoly on that. I hope that that pays for itself and that we're not being a drain someplace else. But you can take that out, and the remaining 60%, the great majority of that, is funded through sales tax and property taxes. So I think as you look down the road, what are we doing to increase sales in this town? What are we doing to increase property values in this town? Because that's going to get you extra money. I grew up in Farmington. We left there in 1963 and moved to St. Genevieve. 6,000 people in Farmington, 1963. What are they now? 18,000. What's Perryville done? They're growing. We're the same population we were in 1950. I really hope as you go through this budget, you have to sometimes invest in the future. And I look around, and we have a lot of work that we do here that uses funds for things, but we're not spending a lot of money on increasing sales revenue or property values. And I think in the long term, if we don't grow that sort of thing, we're going to be fighting this battle year after year after year, and one of these days we're going to die. So I hope as you go through this, you start thinking about what's the city's role in developing sales volume? How do these other towns do it? How can we do it? How can we make it more attractive for people to come here? You all know I've been a big proponent of the National Park. I like history, but that's not the reason I'm a proponent of it. I see it as a way to increase sales and property values here. I learned in business, I was in the defense business, so we had to bid on contracts. If I put all my hope in one contract, there were other people bidding on it, and I might not have got it. So this national park thing has been a 20-year thing. It's still going to happen. We're going to make it happen. But let's look for other things and then do some investment in the future. And I'd like for you to really consider that. Look at what departments are working towards increasing sales, increasing property values. And I think we really have to sit down and have a discussion one of these days is what's the role of the city, how do we interact with chamber and all these other groups to make this happen. Either that or we'll die. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Bobby. Yes, sir, Mr. Burgess.
I'm Jim Ferguson. I don't live in the city, but I live in the county, but I own a business in the city. I'm one of three owners that spent well over $1.5 million to renovate the Audubon Hotel and Restaurant. Did it with a lot of hard labor and a lot of money out of our own, not a lot, all the money out of our own pockets. I read in the newspaper a couple of times about the businesses don't do anything to really support tourism in St. Genevieve. I can tell you we spend thousands of dollars a month out of our own pocket to keep us going down there. To say we make any money, we really don't make any money. I'd be like some of the other businesses in town, we might be better off closing it down, not worrying about paying bed tax, not worrying about paying sales tax, not paying all the other things that we pay out of our pocket. We have Community Tuesdays where we give back to the community. We do a lot of things for St. Genevieve. One of a few businesses, one of the businesses that do a lot for the community. And for us to look at the budget to make the cut that we're doing, I think I brought this up before, we worried about gonna pave our streets and so forth. But if you cut budgets on tourism, where we have a lot of money that I believe that comes in for the people that come into our town, we might not be able to do some paving because we ain't gonna have the money. It's just if nobody comes to visit us and nobody stays at our hotels, whether it be the Inn St. Jim, Main Street Inn, Southern Hotel, Microtel, whoever, we're just not gonna have the money coming in. I wasn't prepared. I didn't realize this was going on. I apologize. I would have had maybe a little bit more script written. I just got the phone call that this was going to happen. But I ditto a lot what Mickey and Jack and Bob have came up with. I mean, we moved to St. Genevieve because we fell in love with St. Genevieve. We bought an old home. We opened a bed and breakfast. We put all of our hard work and money into this town. We then moved into the hotel, the restaurant. Put a lot of our money into this thing. And for people to think that businesses, whether it be the Audubon's or other businesses, aren't putting money into tourism is not correct. I just want to make sure that the board understands it's not just tax monies that we're spending on tourism. It comes out of your budget, it comes out of my budget. So just to let you know that I think that we're going to be cutting off our nose in spite of our face if we make this cut. Again, we have the national park. This has been, like Bob says, been going on for years. We finally got it. And now we're going to throw in a red flag saying we're done? So I really think you need to really look at what the budget has to offer and think about the cuts that you're not proposing, but just look at the budget and give it some thought on the tourism budget. So anyway, again, I'm sorry I wasn't prepared, but after I found out this was going on, I just felt I had to give my 2 cents worth that if it happens, not only is the Inn St. Jean Bouvet that could possibly close, it could be the Audubon, it could be other locations, and then you've got nothing but a main street full of businesses that are closed. One more thing, and I'll shut up because I know you guys want to get going. I was told by one of the wineries I needed to go to this town, and I'm sorry I can't think of the name of the town. And we went there to stay at this historic hotel, and we did. It was okay. They needed to spend some money in the renovation. But when we walked from the hotel to the downtown area, it looked like a ghost town. You could tell they didn't have any money. They weren't spending any money in bringing tourists in. The only place that was bringing them in was that hotel. And, I mean, it was just kind of sad to see that there was, and I don't know, but apparently no money spent to revitalize that area other than the hotel. And so anyway, I just want you to think about what you're doing with the budget, especially the tourism budget, and give it some serious thought. I hate to see any more businesses closing in the St. Genevieve. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Anyone else? That's everybody.
Paul?
Sir?
I wanted to make a comment and stuff. As far as the Kettings and Mr. Mueller and stuff, I've appreciated what you've done over the years, and I think your dedication has been right on and stuff, and I appreciate everything you guys have done.
And I'll second that comment. Thank you for all the volunteer hours that you put in downtown, making people feel welcome. You know, I think it's an added plus and a bonus, and there's There's a lot of, we talk about volunteers. Matter of fact, you guys in the discussion have people volunteer at the Welcome Center, you know, and I'm sure they might step up to the plate to do that, but I just, everybody's needing volunteers. Talk to you, Mike, about this.
Right.
I'm going to see it with the Georgia Fed Committee. They're needing volunteers. Every organization needs volunteers. So I just, I don't know.
I spoke today with Patty Lewis. Ken and Patty Lewis own Lucy Winery. They could not be here tonight because it's harvest. They're racking and bottling wine. But she has spoken to me, they've both spoken to me on several occasions. They moved their business here from near Springfield because they came here as tourists and love the town so much. And I think I could probably name half a dozen small business owners who came here as tourists and now are running businesses or at the very least retired and living here. And I think that says a lot about what we have going on.
Ken and Patty.
Ken and Patty Lewis of Lucy Winery on Main Street.
Okay.
And the old claimers building.
Yes.
Joe?
Not to dispel the importance of tourism. It is definitely important. You know, I brought this up 3 years ago. Former Alderman Ruzicka brought it up last year. And now we're talking about it again. Yes, tourism is very important. The question or not, or the question is, does it take precedence over stuff that we are legally required to have, such as police, fire, water, streets, and all that? You know, to cite some numbers that Sandra gave us last year, county tourism numbers as compiled by the state and not in a scientific manner at all. It's using metrics based off receipts that may or may not be related to tourism. In 2007, it was $12,472,000. In 2017, it had jumped to $17,758,000.
17 million.
$17 million, I'm sorry. That's a difference of $5,286,000. So it is going upwards. It's a 29.8% increase in 10 years. Again, that's using metrics by the state, not real numbers or not using real hard data. Over the same time period, the city's sales tax receipts, however, in 2007 were $1,159,561. 10 years later, in 2017, it went up to $1,256,953 for a difference of $97,392. That's only 3% increase over the same 10-year period, and that's assuming that 100% of that money is related to tourism, which we know is not. So the number is actually less. Over that same 10-year period, the inflation rate of the U.S. dollar is at 18.22%. So our city's sales tax receipts didn't even keep up with inflation, whether it was tourism related or not. Our sales tax receipts did not keep up with inflation. In that time period, I don't have the same 10-year time period. I'm 2 years short of that. I only have 8 years of numbers for actual city spending on tourism. I'm missing 2008 and 2007. But for the 8-year period from 2009, we were spending $40,837 a year on tourism. Jump to 2017, we're spending $249,806,000. The difference is $208,969. That's a 611% increase in spending to see what we assume is a 7.3% gain, if that's 100% related to tourism. The numbers don't add up. The question of whether or not tourism is important, I mean, that's obvious. Tourism is important. Whether or not it should be city funded is another thing. I've brought it up before, former Alderman Ruzicka brought it up before, that we need to start taking direction to form a board, form a 501c over the tourism department. The employees of the tourism department answer to that board. They solicit donations to the 501(c), and with it being a national park, they can get national donors to support that national park, and we need to transition, not just shut it down, transition each year, cut it by, based off their income. Now, if they can come up with the donations, $250,000 worth of donations to sustain them, then we don't have to fund it. But for the city to spend its resources on a, I don't want to say unnecessary, because it is a necessary thing, but it's not required for us to have it. A required thing for us to have is our police force, is our fire department, is our street department, is our water and sewer, and we're making cuts to requirements, required departments, to, when we're spending $250,000 in something that is not required. Is it necessary? Is it important? Yes. But there are other means to, if we set it up and start transitioning away from city funded, it's hard telling how much money that they could make if they were to take that the other direction and become self-funded, governed by their own board of directors, not the aldermen. We don't have much say in tourism or, have specialized people that are in control of making those decisions as a board for them to take that direction. Our responsibility is the infrastructure of the city, the required things that we are supposed to have under state law or even federal law even. And I'm sorry, but $250,000 on tourism is a lot of money when we can't meet our basic needs. It's that simple. And I don't like cutting any department, whether it be tourism, whether it be parks or economic development. I don't like cutting any of them. But when we're not making our necessary means, our necessary obligations to fire, water, police, that concerns me, that we're we're spending $250,000 that can be funded elsewhere if we start moving it in that direction. This $23,000, or is it 23?
23.
Yeah, $23,000, you know, that to me, you know, it would be great if we didn't have to do that. And maybe we don't have to do that. But for right now, I think it is a necessary step in a necessary direction to get to where we need to be. And I just think there's other avenues to fund such something important like that. You got the museum center. They've raised millions of dollars to bring that museum in. Okay, how did they do that? It wasn't people that, you know, they formed a corporation and they solicited donations. Same thing we need to do for the tourism department. I want to see their budget, you know, double. But we can't afford it. If they can go out and form a 501(c) and raise, you know, double the money, more power to them. Put a billboard everywhere they want. I'm all in favor of that. I'm not in favor of the city spending taxpayer money to do it when we can't afford to meet our obligations. A survey was done in 2016 of the residents in St. Genevieve. Tourism came in 9th out of 11 of priorities. Number one was healthcare services. Number two was law enforcement. Three was fire protection. Outdoor recreation, we're talking about cutting the parks department. You know, that was number four on our list.
That's a bad idea.
I'm just saying, that's number four on our list.
Yet, people like recreation.
We have...
You know, what Bob talked about beautification and making the city more attractive for people. That's all, you know,
we're talking about income-based, or tourism income-based. Ms. Ketting, what year did you sell, or did you guys sell Ketting?
99.
So, 99. So, before the city started spending that much on tourism, you still saw a benefit of tourism in that it was making money. Okay, well, our numbers are flat. Even though we're spending 611% more now, our numbers have not increased even to keep up with inflation. So that tourism is going to be there. People that know about us, or people that are interested in history, already know about us. You know, the marketing department and I know this for a fact, when I worked at Microtel, you know, it was great that we had the City of St. Genevieve pamphlets up there, but they're putting one or two of them in every room every night. And they're going to waste, because when they clean that room, they use them as drink holders. And there's more of those being thrown away than are actually being looked at and used. And that is a waste of resources that we should cut down on. They don't need to be in every room. If they're in every room downtown area, that's one thing. Very little of our business at Microtel at the time was tourism related. It's mostly contractors. I think at one time, it was 97% construction related over the 3 years that I tracked it. So only 3% of their business was actually tourism related. And that was on weekends, usually, when the contractors would go home for the weekend. You know, our numbers just don't support, I mean, our real numbers just don't support, number one, the numbers that the state is using. And we can't afford to keep spending $250,000 when we're not meeting our needs. We're coming up with a plan. It's not a drastic amount. Out of $250,000, we're looking at cutting salaries. You know, we talked about getting volunteers down there. That should be easy to meet. Postage.
No, we didn't say it was easy to do.
You said it was easy to do.
No, well, we did not agree on that.
We got to make hard decisions. And I would rather cut something like that than to cut fire, police, or anything that we're required to have by law. The numbers, yes, tourism's important, but it should not be city funded. Not 100% anyways. Or not 92%, whatever it comes out to be, but.
Well, I would also like to point out, kind of hitting up on some points that was spoke about here just a little bit ago. I certainly would agree with the notion that just about all businesses do benefit from tourism in one form or another. But one thing that I would like to hit upon is, even though all businesses may benefit, statistics show that the whole community as a whole does not. So we, as Joe has been saying, we've been flat in our sales tax numbers. We don't have statistics that show that the tourism department is making money. It's actually, I believe, a kind of a consensus that it's losing money. At least that's from what I've gotten in the past and some talks, but it is hard to prove that, I will say. But with that assumption, if the city is losing money on this service, in a whole, it is negatively impacting the non-business owners, you know, my neighbors, you know, I mean, I don't have a business, I do own a business, but not in town, you know, similar to me, that these resources could be used on you know, obligated items that we must support or you know, to help, you know, which it's not going to happen, but help reduce taxes, you know, in that form or another. It's potential that, you know, we spend money on non-essentials that, you know, it has value. I don't disagree with that, but does it have enough value to continue to spend taxpayer dollars on that is not benefiting the tax overall majority of taxpayers? So I just wanted to. My opinion, of course. I think Bob had a comment.
Since you guys know I like history, and when I preface these comments, I want to congratulate the chief on what he's done with the police department over the years. I think they're very professional. When my parents moved here in 1963, we had two policemen. Mm-hmm. Our population was 4,475, I think was our peak. We had an auxiliary police department, and I know that policing has changed a lot in those years, but we now have 12 policemen, 12 police cars. We had a Studebaker Lark, which they got rid of when somebody outran it one night. But things have changed. We didn't have a park budget back 15 years ago, I don't think, or 20 years ago. We've added those things on. Everything changes, but I'm going to just say the same thing again. Do you not see any value of the city investing in trying to improve sales and revenue? Or do you just, if you keep doing the same thing, you're going to get the same thing.
We've invested 611% increase on that, but yet our sales tax receipts have only increased 7.3%, didn't even keep up with the 18% inflation. So how much more do we need to increase it?
We didn't have full-time marketing during that time period. And if you go back to the 80s, we did have. Pardon?
We have it now and it's still flat.
If you eliminate it, I can tell you it's your revenues are going
to
go down.
Well, I'm not saying eliminate it. It needs to be self-funded, and you know.
Well, I think there's a misconception. We've talked about it before. The National Park is not going to advertise St. Genevieve. They do not do advertising. We will still have to do that. They're not going to market the town's heritage other than their park. And Tim Good has told the mayor that. I've been there when he's told him that. So who's going to market the town? And I'm going to ask the same question. It's not just tourism. What are you doing for economic development? I see tourism
well,
as just part of it.
You can't currently afford it, but
you can't afford not to do it either.
Go ahead,
Jimmy.
You mentioned Perryville and Farmington. They're not boxed in by Mississippi Lime and the Mississippi River. We have never expanded our city limits.
And have major highways going through them.
Right.
And we're 4 miles from the major highway.
Well, I got to tell you, there's other towns that are not on major highways that have been successful. Galena, Illinois, town of 2,500. They have 3 men's shops. We have 0. Arrow Rock, 13 miles off of an interstate. They're successful. I've been to Julian, California, 20 miles on a windy, twisty road. On a Sunday afternoon, it's packed. They're famous for pies, and they market their thing. I'm just saying, I think you'll miss the boat if you're not going to work on things that develop economic improvement, because you're going to keep getting the same thing. I don't say that tourism is all of it, Joe. I think it's got to be broader than that. And I'd really like to sometime hear a discussion about what's the city's role in economic development. I haven't heard it for a long time.
Thanks, Ben.
Thank you, sir.
Mike Rainey.
Like to applaud Bob because he's kind of harping on some things that I have near to my heart when it comes to economic development. But I think it's a false choice if we consider that what Joe has said tonight, what Bryant and I have talked to each individual board about, it's a false choice to say that you must choose between economic development and growth of the city and fixing what is relatively a flat top line, or to say get rid of tourism. I think there's some agreement with both sides of this, and I don't think in the letter that I wrote with Bryant anyway, I don't think we're recommending get rid of tourism. I'm not anti-tourism. I'm pro-tourism. And Joe kind of spoke to this, and I would say if funded by the right source, we might need to double that budget. We might need to go out and do way more than we're doing currently. We might need to increase staff. I don't know the answers to that because that's not what I do. What I do know is that we've looked at a budget that does not balance, and that's the issue at hand. So I just want to say from my chair, I'm sure other people agree with me, I'm not anti-tourism, I'm pro-tourism, I'm pro let's get the budget under wraps though, because it seems like it's not. And that's what I'm saying.
Good point, you said it seems like it's not.
That's a good point.
It seems like it's not. And that's what this whole discussion is for me. It's been 2-3 years. We have a figure out here that we can't put a hard number there, but it has worked out. Granted, we are landlocked and we are this town for many more reasons than just being landlocked world and never ever go anywhere else.
But, right, Mr. Mayor, my fear though is that when we say it just works out, And you and I have talked about this personally. I'm a logical person. I try to strip the emotion out of things when it comes to this kind of stuff. So I can't sit here with a good conscience and look at my neighbors in the face and say, this is going to work out, I got to take them some, I got to bring them some cowbell. And I can't do that yet because this spreadsheet doesn't work.
I've been here for two.
I would like to comment on that real quick. I mean, the last few years, yes, have worked out. But we, and this, these are new, or statistics show that we have plenty of years that has not worked out. And these are numbers that I got from Sue. And not counting 2019, just because it's a 10-year that I have, we're 5 for 5. 5 years deficit, 5 years in the green. So the deficits certainly do happen. And statistics that I have show that with this budget passing, it will happen. I will admit, in discussions, I'm kind of shooting from the hip when I say how much I think it'll deficit. If I had to guess, just given off numbers that I've studied, anywhere from 50 to 80,000, we have the emergency fund to cover those, of course. But we just had a discussion stating that we are happy with our emergency fund and we don't want to touch it. So I don't want to touch it. So that is the reason behind this work and trying to at least lessen the blow of the deficit. With these cuts, I think we would get considerably closer to breaking even. You know, as alluded to in the past, it's hard to determine with revenue, you know, jumping back and forth. I mean, on the numbers I have, it's sometimes we're close, sometimes we're $200,000 off. It just, you know, it's difficult to guess, essentially, is what we're doing here. But, you know, with my best educated guess, this will deficit, and I'm just trying to lessen the blow. You know, the cuts, a lot of these cuts made here were right directly off the sheet that was given to us at the last meeting, such as legislative administration. The economic development was the chamber payment. You know, and I have added, of course, as we've seen, those have just been some cuts that I found I thought could be reasonably done.
But did you talk to the? Sorry to interrupt, but did you talk to the folks about these cuts? Did you sit down and talk to David about what your cuts are going to do to his department, or did you talk to Sandra?
But we already know we've had these discussions what these would do.
Sandra,
I will say I have spoken with Sandra. Now it wasn't over these specific numbers. I did not have this quite done yet when we talked. So, but I will say that.
Sorry. Do you mind? I would like to hear from you about, since this is a new cut that you were not really aware of. Could you tell us a little bit about how it's going to affect you?
In the time that I spent with Bob Donovan and Bryant Wolfen on Tuesday of this week, we talked about a lot of things, and we talked about the value of tourism, and specifically that, as I think Mickey and Bob pointed out, tourism brings dollars into our community. It doesn't matter how many dollars you trade across that table. Of course, that's important and it's good to support local business, but our economy doesn't grow unless money comes into the economy, and it comes in the pockets of these tourists. So Bryant did mention to me that he was looking at the budget, and he did mention the word marketing. I knew that was in your crosshairs. I didn't know to what extent. So, you know, the long and short of it is that we need to be spending more money on marketing and not less. And what I hear you saying is that if we want to spend more money on marketing, we need to find it in other places. And, you know, that's a choice. I can spend more money. I could spend more time in grant writing, which I already do. My budget is... And I'm sorry, Bob and Bryant had to listen to this the other day. My budget isn't $250,000 out of the city general fund. It's only $200,000. And the reason that the other $50,000 doesn't come out of the general fund is because I do write grants, and I do look for ways to increase revenues and bring more tours here, to bring more, you know, to increase the economy and also to increase the revenue figure so that there isn't as much burden on the city. So that's what I have done, and my budget isn't 100% on the city general fund. You know, I mean, the solution would be if we want to spend more money on marketing, then we're going to need to find other funds to go to do that. So,
Sandra, I have a question on your marketing. You had mentioned to us Tuesday that you spent to TripAdvisor $10,000 last year, and that's something that was the first time that you had done that. So where did that $10,000 come from? Because obviously you took it from somewhere else.
Exactly. I wrote a grant to get that. I wanted to do a TripAdvisor pilot program. 68% of people use TripAdvisor to plan their travel. So I wrote a grant to do that, and that was paid for 100% by grant funds. None of it was in the general budget, general fund, excuse me.
So that didn't come from any other fund? That was all funded by the grant?
100%.
Okay, I missed that too, Sam.
I do have some questions as far as marketing goes, where some of the money, this is the reason why I asked that question the other day, is the specifics behind, you know, what kind of marketing we're looking into. How much benefit do we see spending $3,000 on a billboard, right, coming into town, or the $4,500, which this is a tax commission, off the billboard, off of 55. You know, and this is just my business, of course, so, you know, I don't have a whole lot to go off of other than my own experience, but given my own experience, I don't believe those two avenues are the best advertising spots to be putting the money. And so they're, you know, I'm open to debate here as well, but that's, you know, one of the reasons why I touched upon marketing. I felt as if, you know, it would be an easier cut because I think we're wasting in some areas. So like I said, that was a personal belief, and that is why I hit that department specifically.
So I have a Tourism Advisory Council and the Tourism Tax Commission Board of Commissioners who we have that dialogue. It's not a board of aldermen. I mean, Martin is my supervisor. You all are the, you know, the legislators here, and you are certainly entitled to your opinion, but you know, there are marketing theories about how many times you have to touch someone's psyche for them to take action. It's called the tipping point. I don't want to go into all this have a whole discussion about marketing sometime if you would like to actually do that. But the way it works is, you know, maybe you see something on your Facebook post, you know, like a ad in your Facebook feed. Maybe you are reading an article and you see news about St. Genevieve becoming a national park. That's a touch on your psyche, and you say, honey, you know, St. Genevieve's going to be a national park. Maybe we ought to get up and go, you know. Maybe the next time you're driving down to take your kids to SEMO and you're driving down the interstate, you see that billboard on Interstate 55 that says, you know, St. Genevieve has lodging and wineries and restaurants and attractions, historic homes, and you're like, huh, maybe we should do it. It takes a certain number of touches on the psyche to create that desire. That's why there's an advertising industry. And, you know, all of those things add up to the person making the decision to take action on that desire. And so when they take action on that desire and book their trip to St. Genevieve, that's when we win, whether they're a day tripper or overnight. And we went through those figures at previous meetings about how much the State Department of Revenue says that an average day tripper spends versus an average overnight spend. When they get in their car and decide to come here, we've won. Because when they get to St. Genevieve, because of all the aldermen who sat in these chairs before you who decided to invest in St. Genevieve and what it looks like and the sidewalks and the levee, because of decisions that were made by people who saw the vision for what St. Genevieve could be and could become, when people come here to St. Genevieve, they fall in love with it. They walk down these sidewalks and they come back to the Welcome Center and they're, we've been thinking about this for years, and I'm so glad that we did it. And give me your calendar of events because we want to come back for Jour de Fête or Rural Heritage Day, or we want to have New Year's Eve dinner here and watch the Lagioni. they are utterly charmed by it, and it isn't thanks to me, it isn't thanks to any of you who are on the board now, it's thanks, well, Buck, it's the only one who's been here long enough to have been part of those decisions. It's thanks to lots of people, and even the National Park coming here, that's been a 20-year effort. I've been working on it for 6 years, as has Martin and other people. The mayor has been working on it for 3 years now, is that? So, you know, it all adds up, and all of that adds to what St. Genevieve has to offer as an experience, as a destination, and building that economy, building the dollars that come into our community. So, yes.
So, and Mr. Mueller, if I misspeak and misrepresent you, please stop me, but you validated a feeling that I had about Martin's priority-based budgeting process that he pitched to us. I still feel that was a missed opportunity. We had a good opportunity to do work, and we chose not to. And I wish then I had stood up and been more adamant in support of that, and I wasn't, and that's my fault. So I don't want to miss this opportunity, and my question to you is,
I didn't know if I was going to sit down or not.
No, we've got to get creative, I think, or we at least have to not have the fear of being creative. Doing what we've always done gets us what we've always got, okay? And this is flat, okay? So why be afraid of being creative? I want to know if you're open to, we're in Joe, same from you, can we form a small committee, you and Joe and somebody else, whoever we need to involve, to investigate what he's proposing? Because I think that's the compromise that we need to look at very hard, because I don't think anybody around this table is going to say, cut tourism, we don't need it. We all seem to agree that we do need it and probably need more of it. We just need to pay for it the right way. Joe has put a lot of thought on this, apparently, and seems to have some answers. Are you willing to sit down with Joe and investigate this possibility?
I think it's intriguing as a possibility. It certainly has merit. If we could spend twice or three times as much on marketing, we would have more results. We have a tiny marketing budget as
right.
It is. So I have no problem. I'm not afraid of having the dialogue, but I do also think that we should use the Tourism Advisory Council members for part of that dialogue.
Whoever needs to
add people to it, maybe
right.
For a special task force or something.
There's an answer in the middle. Let's don't be afraid to do something we haven't done before. There's an answer in the middle. Joe said some smart things. You're brilliant at what you do. I don't know where a billboard belongs. I don't want to study that.
I know if I want sausage, I'm going to Stani's.
And there you go. You know that probably because of the billboard.
That's right.
So.
The billboard. Go down the highway.
I just would hate, I would hate to miss the opportunity.
I'm here at Oberlin's, but it's different sausage. Oberlin's is great sausage.
I mean,
stay local.
You know, Sandra, one more comment, and that was part of the reason for the meeting Tuesday. And you know, I just wanted to plant some seed for other opportunities that we're not now pursuing. It just seems like we've been so closed, you know, on this whole budget thing. And I know the administration has said we just need to do it. We need to kick the can down the road, worry about it at the end of next year if we're in a deficit. I don't agree with that at all. I think we need to address it now. If we do come up with additional funds, we have plenty of places to spend them. But, you know, as far as, you know, the Welcome Center and stuff, I think a solution to that, you know, we can all sit here and debate whether the ends justify the means. We've talked about it for years. There's no way to put a number to that. But I just ask, you know, that we be open, we think about things, we source those opportunities that are out there, whether it's donations or volunteers or whatever it might be, that it just isn't 100% at the expense of the taxpayers in the city. I think that would be a good
time. It's not 100% now, and I'm open to having that dialogue.
$200,000 is. But anyhow, I think we need to look at whatever opportunities are out there, wherever they may be. We might have hit on a few of them. Maybe we didn't. There's ideas out there and stuff that we just need to look everywhere at every possible thing.
Well, and I appreciate your comment about, you know, in 6 months, we watch how the revenues are coming in. Maybe we're in a better situation, and maybe we can revisit that. 6 months would put us about at the time for the spring travel season to begin. So maybe that's a time to look at it and say, can we genuinely afford to do a little more?
We make budget amendments all the time. I don't want to pull the plug on anything. It's just we have to transition to fund it in a different manner, is my opinion. And the people have even said that there's other priorities, you know. I'm not saying pull the plug. We need to transition it to, or try to. I mean, maybe it won't work, but we need to at least try it. And look at the possibility. If it's $20,000 this year, you know, I mean, it takes us 10 years to transition out of it, then it takes us 10 years. But, you know, I just don't think, you know, Bob had brought up that the National Park Service is not going to do any marketing or promoting and all that. They can't. They say that they can't spend state taxpayer money on that kind of stuff. Federal. We shouldn't either, and that's what a lot of people think. You know, if it's not right for them to advertise, then we shouldn't either. That's why it needs to be a different form.
It's a little bit different here, Joe. We benefit from it.
Show me the numbers, because our sales tax revenues don't support it.
Joe, I'll tell you what. I've made my mind up. I'm not arguing. This board, you decide. The only time I'm going to, you guys, this is your, I consider this the board's
Senator,
budget.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You do what you want to do, and I'm good with it.
Joe,
I'm not going to fight.
I would just like you to consider that the tourism dollars are new dollars, and those numbers that you have are a lot of people that live here but are spending their money out of town, buying groceries, buying cars.
The numbers I have are sales tax receipts for the city.
Yes. My point is that the people who live here might be going elsewhere and spending their money. The only new money coming in are folks that are here from out of town. That is new money coming in.
What is that based on?
I disagree with that.
Well,
tourists
come here to shop the country.
That's your theory of where the money's coming from.
Right. What I'm saying is, it is an infusion of new money coming into the community. And we may, and some of these numbers may be flat. I'm no economist, but I know a lot of people who go out of town and go out for entertainment and get their groceries out of town. We can't say these numbers are flat because there's no tourism and because there's no new money coming in.
I'm not saying there's no tourism. I'm saying that.
But if the numbers are flat, it's not.
The 611% increase we've spent didn't even keep us up with the inflation.
But that's saying that all of that growth or lack thereof is strictly visitors. But I'm saying a lot of our
which we know it's not.
I guess I need to see your numbers and where everything's coming from.
Okay. Can I just say something here real quickly? I mean, I'm really sorry that I missed your last meeting, right? I really am. It was unavoidable and everything else. You guys went on for 2.5 some hours, right? For this. So I thought you had the managers come here and offer you ideas to reduce costs. And wasn't that agreed upon?
No.
And I thought we hired people to manage departments the best they possibly can. And if we don't have trust in our people who are managing, then fire them. And if we want to reduce costs, get rid of some cars, get rid of some cops, reduce the insurance coverage, let's get down to brass tacks. But I'm tired of this conversation. I like the due diligence you did. Thank you. Let's come to a conclusion. Tourism is a necessity here. And you can give me numbers all day long. That's fine. Your mind's not going to change. Your vote's not going to change. Can we please move this on? Let's take the professional's opinion and vote on it. Otherwise, maybe we should start reviewing these managers and our insurance and our cars and our cops and our equipment.
We don't have to be loud.
We don't.
We don't.
How many times do we have to meet here? The same statistics and the same
things? I don't
know.
I've met every one of them, okay?
Move on.
Well, I think this matter is this the same conversation reoccurs.
What I hear is the same conversation talking about going after the Welcome Center. Okay, we get it, we got it.
Well, I think we're going after more than just the Welcome Center here.
Yes.
And that's why I did this. You know, I didn't want to come in and just straight cut the Welcome Center, but that's been proposed.
Okay, then. If you want to cut the Welcome Center by $25,000 or whatever, right, then I think we can get rid of the leases and some of, maybe even talk about reducing staff with the police, because Bob said they used to run with two cops. Why do we have 12? And by God, I love my cops and I love my defense.
I'm certainly open to discussions. I mean, this, we went out and asked everybody to do these numbers, and so that's what we did.
Fine.
I went off those, and you know, if you think we should cut police or fire more, I'm certainly open. Trust me, I think if anybody here wants to cut, it's me.
Okay.
So
I don't mean to get all heated up and stuff. I'm just, oh my gosh, I'm tired. I'm not feeling well. How many times do we have to meet to beat this dog to death?
Well, this is the most important thing that we do as a board.
It's not an easy solution.
And
Gary. It's not a black and white and stuff. We're looking for solutions. We're looking for solutions from a lot of different people. You know, and that's why there's discussion over it.
I just feel like this conversation for some reason has been focusing on one department. Is it just me?
Brent, and I don't mean to be disrespectful at all, but this is important, but I don't think this is the most important thing what we all do. You know, you're all voted on by the people to serve the people, and I know this is part of it, but serving the people is more than just crunching numbers at a budget. It's spending time with the people, spending time with your staff, and serving the community. And we get looking at it toward different kind of leadership, but the greatest leader of all is a servant leader. And we got to continue to think about that serving, you know, and the people that come into this town, the tourists that come into this town, and I see a lot of tourists come into town. I spend a lot of time downtown, talk to people. I've directed people. We're here to serve those people too, because they're a valuable asset. Our customers, they're our customers. We got to take care of them. It's a balance between our customers and our employees. Got to have a great, healthy mix. And I'm all. Well, numbers are not my gig. They're your gig. You're a businessman. But I look at things a lot different. And all we do, every one of these meetings, all I hear is we have people that get hurt and our employees that get hurt because we can't settle and decide what we really want to do. And I'll meet as long as you guys want, but sooner or later we got to vote on a budget. So, and I'm all about doing that. If you want to vote on this budget, you want to vote on these cuts, it's up to you. And if you want to play Russian roulette with tourism, it's your choice.
Well, I think we're playing Russian roulette with more than just tourism, as I said. And you know, unfortunately, we don't live in a perfect world. And one thing, and I completely agree with, the most important thing we do is serve our constituents. Right. So,
it's not always about money.
This is the... we are dealing with taxpayer dollars here. This is their hard-earned dollars. This is
my hard-earned dollars. I'm a taxpayer.
Your hard-earned, it's hard to say, dollars that when you're going out to Country Mart and Dollar General and eating at restaurants downtown. I mean, that's your money that's going to the city, and it's everybody's money that's going to the city. So we have to make sure that we are spending their money wisely.
And my requirement for me is for Paul is. I like the fact that I don't lock my doors at night. Don't have to. I feel safe. I got a police force that is above and beyond. I don't worry about my. I know if I make a call, the fire department's going to be there. You know, I know that when I got a pothole up there on Academy Street, all I got to do is make a call, or somebody makes a call, tells me about it, we get it taken care of. Great services. We provide great service in this city, and just like your store And I don't want to raise taxes, but I'm willing to buck up and pay for those great services. We have a police department with the guys who are not getting paid like they should. And you can cut this budget all you want, but you can't find the money it's going to take to reward these guys for the service that they do.
I'm
proud to say that I'm passing for that vote, and I've taken a lot of grief from a few of my very best friends. But I'm for it. This city hall here, when I make a call, when I come in here, it's a friendly place, and they provide good service. Well, and I'm willing to pay for it. And I believe that there's a whole lot of people in this community who are willing to pay for it. So,
well, when you raise the people's taxes because you can't afford something and you have so much money going towards a non-essential, then, I mean, that's a problem. I mean, I would, I don't know if it's possible, but why wouldn't it be worth a vote to throw Welcome Center dollars out to? I mean, we do it for a municipal band, I'm sure there's got to be somewhere out there that you can raise a sales tax. I'm not advocating for that, but I'm just saying, you know, if we want to fully fund this thing, you know, put it out to the taxpayers, like, as done everything else. I mean, I wouldn't be in favor of it, but I mean, that's the argument here.
I don't see where we need to.
And, well, I mean, we just went out and...
There's no statutory authority for that. The lodging tax.
The lodging tax, correct. But obviously, we can't maintain within the binds of that lodging tax because it doesn't provide nearly enough for what is needed or for what we're currently doing. So, you know, as I said, the biggest problem here is we're trying to be good stewards. We're trying to make sure the money is being spent wisely. And in my opinion, as you said before, this is my opinion, passing a budget that's $221,000 in the hole is, even though it may not show that way in the end, but it could also be worse, because I also have statistics that have showed we passed a negative budget, it's been worse. Mm-hmm. But it could go both ways.
And
if we cut
that out, it could be even worse.
It could.
Because we don't know. You don't know. And that's the problem with doing that is you don't know.
But that goes both ways.
Sure.
So.
But all I'm saying is we go forward and you can accuse me of being a poor steward or whatever, but I think we're just, I don't know.
I just want to say something for the record. First of all, I wanted to apologize.
Thank you.
I got heated, and you're my peers, and I'm not mad at anybody, and I'm a Christian. I love you all. And I know I get heated, that's my family, and my indoor voice is an outdoor voice. So I apologize to my constituents and my aldermen, the mayor and the people here, I really do. And I really think your due diligence on this is great, and I think that you did some work, and I the cuts, okay? And I do think the police are a necessity, I don't want to cut them. Our employees are phenomenal, I don't want to cut their salaries or their insurance, to make that for the record. But I do feel that although you did this great work, this is something we can chew on for the future. And I just think that we should go with the management's cuts to begin with and then have this conversation later.
What management cuts are you talking
last
about?
Last meeting.
Yeah, you're not going to like those cuts.
Those cut $68,000 out of the police department.
Yeah, that was that includes reduction of six bulletproof vests.
I do fully agree with what he's saying and go forward with the budget.
I just wanted you to know what the impact was of what you were about to say. Because
part of it, I go to a lot of the park board meetings, and it's discouraging. And now we're going to strip the park of those people. Why would anybody want to be on the park board?
I will say most of these park board cuts are more reductions closer in line to what is used every year.
But there's other factors behind those that nobody asked me about.
I would love to hear those.
Well, you cut the sand, gravel, mulch. You know, that what I spent this year was just mulch. There's a parking lot at Pinkley Park. There's a road at Valley Spring that goes down off the hill. All these rocks. Need some riprap out there to ditch. That's all out of that line item that you're saying I didn't spend this year, so you're going to cut it next year.
Well, it's been multiple years. It wasn't just one year. I went back
building maintenance. That's not just the park house and the shop. That's all the pavilion. You know, I consider them a building. They all need painting. Two of them need roof work. The roof for the gazebo downtown is bigger than that line item.
City Hall up here.
So.
Yeah. I was asked
none of these questions. Yeah. And, you know, you take the $5,000 from the park board.
Yes.
That's all they spent. You know, last year they replaced.
But is that an infrastructure?
Yes.
Okay.
That's the only money they get to spend in the year.
They spent that on the disc golf up there. Now they got some money.
And last year they replaced all the barbecue grills. We put up two swing sets. And this year they went to. Part of it's going to the disc golf, since that's the only growing thing in the park. You know, we figured it was good to allocate some funds to them. The rest of it, we're going to buy some trees to replace trees that are dying, to put some more trees around the walking path that's going to hopefully get redone in the next year or two with some grants. But, you know, that's the only money they got to spend.
Yeah, like, and this is all debatable. I'm not saying this is perfect.
But Brian, why are we bringing up all this now without talking to the folks that are determining their budget? We trust the department.
That's what we've been trying to do this entire year, and it's not, you and I think would both agree that that's not what happened. I mean, how many budget sessions have we had to where we've had all these opportunities that we just run out of time on?
I sat up here on my budget in front of everybody, and I got to ask two questions.
Some of these questions, it comes up at a later time. And, you know, as I said, this is a mix of cuts that have came to us at the last meeting, and it's certainly debatable. I mean, we can take whatever from this, and we can do whatever we want. That's what we're here to do. As I said, it was asked, when did we have our meeting? Last Monday, or whenever it was? It was asked to make another budget within the time frame that I did start on this budget, try to get it done by tonight. It was very difficult to meet up with everybody. I met with Eric, I met with Sandra, and I'm sorry, Gary, for not reaching out and meeting with you. I was on a time restraint, but it was asked to do that. This is an idea that we came up with, and so I'm just trying to make some, at least moving forward here, because I think we would all agree our discussions have almost been waste of time.
Thank you, though.
Thank you.
45 minutes, though, is a waste of time.
There's an old saying out there.
Those budget meetings at 45 minutes.
Well,
in this case, I think it's, if it's not broke, don't break it.
Well, I would argue that a $221,000 deficit is a broken system.
I disagree with you.
And that's why we're a board.
But like you say, it's my opinion.
That's why we want tourism to bring in more money, which brings revenue up to get us closer to numbers.
You're not here in opposition to that, though, Gary, I don't think. At least not from my seat. I mean, I think we're compelled to pass a budget that balances. And I'm the newest member of the board, and I don't mean to overstep. And if somebody wants me to adjust my thinking, let me know.
Which has nothing to do with general revenue budget, but mine varies so much. I can spend $5,000 a year on salt, or I can spend $50,000. Well, if I spend $50,000, I'm paying 10 times the overtime. I'm paying more repairs, more fuel, more equipment repairs. You know, the same way right now with mowing grass. We shouldn't be mowing every week in the middle of September. Mm-hmm. So I'm spending more in fuel, I'm spending more in repairs, which you want to cut me $1,000 out of my repairs in the park. You know, my equipment's getting older, the parts are getting more expensive.
But so not denying you that money, though. Not denying you that money, Gary. Like, if you need to go above and beyond.
Well, you're cutting it out of my budget, you are.
But you still have to spend. Yeah, you still have to. You need to spend the money, so we talk about it as a board and we make that decision. It's just I just think it's a false choice to say that we
want
to
manage your department.
No, that's absolutely right, Buck. I don't.
Sure you are. You're telling me that I got to spend this money, or I can't spend this money. That's not managing my department?
I don't think so. I think what I personally think.
Can I hear anybody else's opinion on this?
Given historical evidence here, given historical evidence here with a lot of these cuts, infrastructure, sure, I took that directly off your page last time. But some of these that I didn't was specifically going off of history and my estimations, you would not come to us for unless something happened. I'd have to go through it real quick, but I mean, to keep it short, I cut it down to the amount that has not ever even been touched. So, you know, like on the 2000 for equipment, or maybe it was operating.
That was equipment rental.
I don't.
Would
yeah,
you
that, you're
on that. Special services.
There was a couple of them, like I said, that I did take off your sheet. And then, but some of the ones that I added in here that weren't on your sheet or historically
I had
you would
no
not come
sheet.
To us for.
I had no sheet. I was called and asked about two line items that were special services, and I forgot what the other one was. The special services could go away. That was back when we still had the ball fields and it was for dumpsters.
Brian, let me jump in for just a sec. This is Vernon here. What I recommend, though, Gary, is that it sounds to me like you each developed a budget or responded to questions individually in a silo. Budgets were created in a silo. And nobody oversaw, department by department, how does that overaffect the umbrella budget that is presented to us that we assess may in fact come in negative. So
That's a good word.
No, he's absolutely right. May come in at a surplus.
Seems like it might be.
You're not wrong, Mr. Mayor. However, we need to operate on the best analysis that we've done. My point being, how do we know that if those silos were taken down and department heads met as a group and worked on the overall city budget together? I know you're like me, man. You don't know where a billboard needs to go. Sandra doesn't know how to patch potholes. I get that. But if you guys worked together and brought us, because what I assume is supposed to happen, this board is supposed to approve or disapprove, not create.
A budget.
Not item by item. Not item by item.
But you're saying me to come back to the board item by item.
Sir, we're both agreeing. I hope you understand that. And what we're agreeing on is if that work happens before it's brought to the board, and you guys do your level best to present a budget that's balanced, maybe at a surplus, maybe negative, whatever your best number is, come to the board then and let us approve or disapprove.
We take our budget to Martin, he looks it over, we go over it, it comes to you, we sit here in front of you. I get asked two questions.
Okay, and so in response to Gary, and I appreciate your passion because I feel probably the way you sounded, but what I'm saying to Gary is that we were brought a budget where department heads cut. And Eric, man, what did you cut? I mean, you cut an officer and you cut some bulletproof vests. That was not acceptable to me.
And a dog.
And yeah, so I mean, we can talk about cutting cars. We can talk about the value of having the number of officers on the force, all that stuff.
And I was making that point.
Who else feels compelled?
And you were.
And I agree with you.
I don't want to cut any of the cops.
I agree with Gary. I agree with everything the mayor said. Who else feels compelled to pass a budget that's balanced, though?
I do.
Yep.
I do.
That's good business, and this is a business. And unfortunately, we are, you know, and these cuts are 6% of our budget. That's it. I mean, it's a big percentage.
Well, that's what we're going to vote on. You know, we're going to vote on, it's an up and down vote. It's going to be, we're going to need to vote on a budget. So.
But which budget? Are we going to go with these new cuts? Are we going to go with some of the cuts from last week? Are we going to trust the department heads? Because when they don't use $50,000 for sand, we know it's going to go back into the general fund.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, sir.
Does the raises have to be discussed before you can approve a budget?
No.
No.
I guess what
is that not part of the budget?
Sure, raises have to be discussed.
I think so. I think that's the reason why there's a stipulation that there's a review process where reviews are due on 1 July.
I'm not seeing any raises here.
No.
But we can do a budget amendment. If we can't decide.
That's what you said the other day. You said we voted.
How do you not get a balanced budget, Gary, if you don't include the raises?
Please. What you said the last meeting was we can vote up and down on a straight budget. If we're going to do raises, we come back and do that later in the year. That's what you said.
Yeah. Assuming you're budgeting the current salaries, you have to adopt the budget. Salaries have to be part of the budget. Raises don't have to be part of the budget.
What I sense some of the frustration from, or the passion, whatever you want to call it, is from the board on it. The ones that want a balanced or the ones that are okay with the way it is. I think in looking at Mike and Bryant's numbers, and when I had questioned a couple of the things, actually several of the things, the one that stands out the most is the MDT cards for the police department. When I saw that cut in there, I immediately thought, okay, well, those MDT cards up front cost us money, but on the back end, they save us money because then dispatch isn't charging us for those particular radio dispatches. And that's how they determine how much they charge us each year for dispatching services and number of calls. The MDT terminals cut down on that. So whenever I was questioning about that, I talked to the chief, I talked to Bryant once. I don't know if it was about that, but anyway. It was stated, the chief had told me that that was the amount that he's looking to cut, the 1,200 or whatever it was not being used. We're still going to keep the data cards, nothing's changing, but that was an amount that was over budgeted and has been over budgeted. So what Mike and Brian are looking for is to go through each department from top to bottom and find other areas just like that where there's more budgeted than we realistically need and try to get that deficit lowered. And we've asked for that, and I'm not sure that we've delivered. I mean, and I'll use Gary for an example. Hey, we need to make some cuts to your department. And he looks at his whole budget, he finds one item, okay, I can do without that, that's good enough. But it's not making cuts, it's fine-tuning the numbers that are there and making them more realistic. I'm not saying you have to cut anything, just fine-tune the numbers and make them more realistic.
So it looks good? So it looks good on paper?
Make it more realistic. Why
so it looks good on paper.
But in the case of the MDT cards, we were budgeting more than we were using from year to year.
And we didn't spend it, though. So it looks good on paper that we don't have it.
That's what a budget is. It's an idea on paper.
Right. And yeah, why not have those figures to be exact?
That's what a budget is, Paul. It's
so, I mean, right. Jimmy.
How many more meetings are we going to have? I mean, I've been to these meetings since May. I'm retired. I can do it. But some people work. Yeah. And I'm just getting tired of sitting here for 2.5 hours. I don't think we're making, we're no closer than we were last May.
No, we're absolutely not. We just, all we do is argue every time.
I just want to get something done.
Well, I just said we need them.
How are we closer?
If nothing else, we're setting expectations for what we expect next year.
Okay, well, I'm not doing that.
The same thing we talked about a year ago.
I know that.
We're going to set expectations and stuff, and it got...
But, Bob, we've had these meetings. We haven't done it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
We have a better idea going forward.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Sure. Now you're hitting on something. Now
you got
maybe
it.
We just go ahead and make a motion to adopt the budget that's at hand. See what it goes. If you want to vote yes, you want to vote no, or we can go back, because if you vote no, and we have to come back and do more meetings, because we got to deliver a budget.
Well,
so
we can't vote in a work session anyways, can we?
No.
You give us, you tell me what you want on the agenda at your next meeting.
I'm going to have another, I would like to see us, I would like to see the budget that was proposed when we began
which
all this.
Which one?
The original one.
We're going to have a vote, and if we don't decide it, let's vote on it. That's it. And you guys will have an opportunity for yes or no.
Jesus. I like that, Mayor.
I think, and if it comes to, if it's... I mean, we just vote on it, and if that don't work, then we have to do some more work, I guess.
If you don't have a budget by the end of September, the current budget is in effect until you adopt a new one.
Can we unofficially vote on that tonight so we have an idea moving forward?
What's that?
The original budget. Can we?
Okay, we can.
Well, I mean, I'm not saying as a motion. No, I'm just saying
we're saying what budget we want to bring to the table the next time we get together.
Yeah.
Correct.
So let's do that.
And
is that okay
start,
with everybody?
Start with the original. I said OG.
Yeah, but
that's
I mean,
my age. That's my age.
Are we not going to give the department heads a chance to look at this and review it? And
I certainly wish I would have... Really wish I would have done this sooner.
Well, they've looked at it, Bob. We've had two.
And I sent it out to them as soon as I got it.
And I would have originally done this because this would be ideal. Send it to Martin. Send it out to department heads. You guys come to us and
yeah, I got this.
I can tell you right now,
yesterday.
this going through this didn't take me 10 minutes. I put a lot of time into really thinking and bouncing. Bouncing off Mike and really trying to just come with an alternative proposal. I'm by no means saying this is perfect. Quite frankly, I think we all probably know I don't really like this budget because there's other cuts that I would like to see. But
I agree.
I'm trying to compromise by placing this out there.
Well, I like your first. You know, we can talk and everything all night long. But you got something to say before you do?
Yeah, I want Eric to come up to the podium, please.
Mr.
Sir? Eric, this number, the $7,600 and stuff, this is a number that you pretty much agreed to.
Yes.
Without really harming any major services.
Yes. As far as the MDT air cards, I mean, there was, I think both people are correct. I mean, we have moved, we changed service. There's a service that they offer now called FirstNet. It's a law enforcement, public safety-based system that saved us some money, but it comes off of our telephone line item now. So those three line items have all, within the last few years, have been separated. Everything did come out of the telephone. We tried, for budgeting purposes, to keep that a little bit more linear. And so there's some give and take there. If we're over budget on the telephone, typically it's made up in MDT until we can get all that lined out. But yes, the cuts that were on that were ones that were almost to the penny what we had
so
proposed.
And your budget being one of the larger ones, larger departments and stuff like that, in all honesty, and maybe that's not the right term, is this it? Is there more? I mean, could you fine-tune this anymore? Is there something else you could do without cutting essential programs?
I can cut whatever you want me to cut, Bob.
See, there's where, Bob, that's where we're back to where we had that was $80,000 he come up
Let
with the last
question. Oh, I'm not. You know, we is could, there we anything could else in your opinion?
We could find, again, I presented a budget last time that we could work with. It cuts a lot of vital things, but
well,
again, if we're looking
willing.
At spending money or saving money, I can operate with whatever you guys give me to operate. Granted,
we
didn't have.
I know mules has been brought up amongst discussions. Is that an essential service? Could you? I know you elaborated on that a little bit last time. Could you?
Was that one of the cuts that was on the?
Not on this one, but
it was on yours.
Yours, yeah. And I did not add that in. But
again, that was a recent
up.
Addition with the MDTs and the CAD system that we got through dispatch. They provide the mules connection now. So that was.
So even if we didn't cut it on this budget, you don't need
we
it.
We would not spend it.
Correct. Right.
You're not going to spend it anyway. That's my whole.
Yeah.
All these cuts, he's not going to spend them anyway. What? I don't.
Yes.
Just so. But it looks good on paper.
I'm just looking for efficiencies. I'm just looking for.
No, you want it to look good on paper.
But
why would you budget
for something you're not going to spend, though? That's the.
Well, then that's what you're talking about, and Brian hit on it. We've learned a lot. I think we've learned a lot here in this last bunch here. We got to start somewhere, and then, yeah, let's identify that, but you can't do it just at the end in September. It's got to start in January. It's got to start somewhere along the line.
Agree.
Okay, so, but we're going to talk here until we're blue in the face. We need to adopt the budget.
I agree with that. So what?
You don't agree with too much stuff. That's all you do is
what,
agree.
What is? I want you to like me, Mr. Mayor. I want you to like me.
Oh,
so
yeah.
What? Can you tell me what the amendment process is and assure people around this table that if there's an amendment that is required, can one alderman propose an amendment?
Yes.
Okay. So there's a vehicle in place. I come to who if I want to make a?
Well, the prior city attorney had suggested to us that anytime an alderman wants something on an agenda for discussion, he should get a second before he brings it to the board. So,
okay.
So if you want to bring something up, you call Jimmy and say, this is something I want to bring before the board.
Okay.
Will you second my motion? If Jimmy says, yes, I will, you call me.
Okay.
And say, I've got a motion, and I'm going to make this motion, he's going to second it, put it on the agenda.
Because I am getting the feeling that we're in danger of adopting the budget that is in force now. So we'll probably have to exercise that amendment process.
Well,
his gut feel.
There's another process you want to go through it. I don't know what it is. I tried.
You did, and I give you credit.
And I've said this before, if you adopt a budget in September, you can adopt another budget in October. You're not wedded to that budget for a year. You can continue this process. You can, anytime thereafter, say, we're going to amend the budget, and it can be major, it can be substantial. It doesn't have to just be item by item. We come to you with a budget amendment whenever, the only reason we come for a budget amendment is if an expenditure exceeds, not a line item, but a categorical expenditure. So if the police department is going to go over,
not in how many pencils they bought, but in kind of a category of supplies. And we've got to adjust the supply item in order to reflect the overage. But other than that, we don't come to you. We act within the confines of the budget you give us. But once again, you aren't forever committed to the budget you vote in September. If there's a process you'd like to follow, and we can refine that budget thereafter, approve the budget that was submitted, and let's get to work on the refining process.
I'm in the belief, and I could definitely be wrong here, but if we can't make up our minds during this budget process, it's not going to happen. There would be no refining, and that's what I believe.
I think you're right.
My opinion. Once it gets past this
frankly,
budget
you're right.
Process,
we don't have any more information to give you.
That's exactly
you've
right.
Got it all.
Yeah. What else can we do?
But that's why we trust the department heads, and we know that if they don't need to spend something they've budgeted for, it's going to come back at the end of the year.
Well, which it always does.
Yeah. So why?
Well, not always it does, but it does most times.
Here's my problem with I don't, and I hope this isn't the belief because I certainly do trust the department heads. The problem here is can't afford them. According to this budget, it will deficit. Like I said,
You didn't say you can't. You're being dogmatic.
I cannot say.
So according to that budget, it will.
I cannot.
If every department head spends every dollar that's budgeted, and sales tax revenues do not rise above our estimated revenues, you're right. Now, so far in the last 5 years, anyway, you know we've seen two things happen. One is our sales tax revenues. They haven't gone up substantially, but they've risen a little bit every year over the last 4 years. And every department head has spent less than was budgeted because we approached the budget as a worst case, and then we've had this conversation before. Mm-hmm. How much am I going to have to spend for fuel? I don't know. It could be $3.50 next, you know, over the next year. So what do I budget? Do I budget the $2.50 it is today, or do I budget some possible increase? Well, we don't have to budget the possible increase. That's what you're telling us. This is what it was. Just keep it at that. You know, Gary guesses on sand and gravel. How much do you think you're going to buy? He tells you what he thinks he's going to need. He may not need it all, and when he doesn't buy it, if he doesn't need it.
Is it possible to take this list we got last Monday, identify what, such as mules or the air cards, are not cuts, but just
tweaks.
Yes, or more accurate depictions, because Eric did his budget very early, and now he knows that he doesn't need that 1,500. Correct me if I'm wrong. So, can we identify from this list which of these items are just more accurate depictions of what the department heads think they're needing? Plus, I believe
it's this list, right?
The list you gave out last Monday.
Yes.
And, you know, Kenny said we don't need to pay for the phone and internet for the former chief. Okay, I think we can all agree. He's offered to let that go. Let's let it go. He doesn't need 500 to write grants anymore because he's writing the grants. He seemed comfortable with that. Can we identify things like that everyone is extremely comfortable with that will not affect our safety or our health?
I totally agree with you. But let's vote on a budget and get it done and then do that.
Okay.
That's all.
Fair
enough. And then we can make an amendment.
Okay.
I mean, what is the big deal there?
That's the point I was trying to get to, Eric. And stuff was just give us a realistic number, and Gary, a realistic number based on your professional opinion,
assurance then that when we come over budget at the end of the year, we're not going to get browbeaten because we couldn't operate within the budget that you guys cut. And I would like to address another concern that has come up every year since I've been here and was addressed tonight. We didn't run 24 hours coverage in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s. There are 7 employees that work in City Hall. That's okay, but we can't have that are here from 8 to 5, but we can't have 11 officers to cover 24 hours a day, 7 days a week without an annual criticism. I don't think it's
crime is different today than it was in 2000.
The demographic is different. Again, they were running a call box and
when you came in the morning, if the light was illuminated, they knew they had a call sometime the night before. So things have changed since the 50s, since the 60s, since the 70s, since the 90s.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think what we are running is egregious or absurd or over the top. You know, I think that we have a good department. I think we have a good city. Mm-hmm. So I understand that the population hasn't changed, the demographic has changed, and the amount of service that we provide has changed.
It's not
going to
get better.
It's not going to get better.
Let's stop locking your doors.
Right. You should lock
your doors. Shouldn't have said
that. No. You should lock your doors.
What's your address?
I like them all too.
Especially when it's on TV. Yeah. You said that on TV, you realize that, right?
Come on in.
There's nothing in my house I'm willing to.
Me neither. That's why I'd ask.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, now.
Thank you very much, Eric.
Thanks, Eric. So, I would like Martin to present us a budget, the budget that we started out with. To have an up and down vote on the budget, the original budget. Do you want to do
right now? Or?
No, I'm just saying he's going to bring that to the meeting on next Thursday.
Yeah.
He's going to bring that. It's going to be on the. It's going to be on the to vote to for the first reading of that, and then we're going to vote on it.
Yeah, I like it.
Is you okay with that?
I think Susie had a good idea that wouldn't take a lot of man hours.
I said we're going to be bringing a vote in.
Yeah, absolutely, you did.
But
absolutely.
And we talked about this. You asked this question several times about amending the budget. We can still do that. But
sure.
Why not?
We can answer. why don't we answer that question?
Why don't we answer that question
for your meeting next week? And then, as you consider the budget as presented, you can take that information and add or subtract from that however you want to. And then. And then at the second meeting in September, you'll have a budget that you will vote on.
And my response to that is I would like to get out of the business of reviewing and screening and tweaking a budget. I'd like you guys to do that. She's made a recommendation that we incorporate those numbers and then bring that as the budget that we vote on. And I'm okay if we don't.
Well, except there are some things on here that you fundamentally disagreed with.
Yeah.
You fundamentally, we weren't going to cut the, you said we weren't cutting the police, we weren't cutting the fire.
I would rather not.
So the ones that make sense to cut,
yes.
not the ones like the bulletproof vest.
Right. Thank you,
no,
Pam.
No.
Thank you, Pam.
And these are very small cuts.
The simple cuts like the...
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay. The simple cuts.
For instance, administrative,
not, yes.
Yeah. I'm good.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it's...
Yeah.
And there's nothing, there's no life safety question as to whether we have a cleaning service once a week or twice a week.
But I don't want to go and I'm seeing on your, cutting the building maintenance, we can't afford to cut building maintenance. We don't do a good job of taking care of our buildings.
Well, except the idea there was the legislative was just this building, and we're going to spend capital improvement money to remodel it, which will cover pretty much our building maintenance needs.
Yeah, but don't cut it in. Gary's got buildings.
Well, that's not Gary. That's just City Hall.
And this is on this sheet here, not the sheet that Brian brought to the table.
No, sheet from
we're not that sheet. We're not doing anything with. Just
what have
this.
We spent on building maintenance on the FEMA building? Anything?
We fixed leaks in the roof occasionally. Otherwise,
so minimal.
Yeah, they're obligated for ordinary maintenance. We agreed for parking lot maintenance and roof maintenance. That's all. And occasionally they call me and say we have a leak. Gary calls Sergeant Construction. 6 months later, they might come out.
So are we going to do raises, talk about raises next meeting so we get this all done?
It's up to y'all.
Well, before we get to that, you had made a comment about whether we were going to pay any attention to what Mike and Bryant did. In your tweaking of the numbers that were brought up on the Monday that I missed, I still think you need to compare side by side with the numbers that Mike and Brian came up to maybe identify some other line items that, and that's across the board to everybody. I'm not picking on a single department here. Use theirs as a guide to say, oh, well, they found an issue here. Let's take a closer look at that and see if there's cuts.
Some of these are policy decisions.
Right.
Do you want to support the Chamber's economic development or no? He said no.
Do you want to contribute to the New Bourbon Port Authority, which is legislative contingency? He's taking it out. That's a policy decision. I can't make that decision.
They need to stay in there, I think.
I don't know.
At least now.
That's my point.
Yeah, I mean, we need to keep paying.
What are our benefits?
You have as much information as I have.
She can. Tina come with the chamber with the benefits.
We give $2,500 as a member of the New Bourbon Port Authority. The county, Perry County, City of Perryville, what's the other? It's Perry and
And the hopes is economic development on that. If the port, they do some work at the port, that'll benefit the community.
You ask me what benefit we get? I can't give you a number. I don't even have a vote. They said, you need to go to the New Bourbon Port Authority meeting. I said, why? I said, well, because you're a member. I said, do I get to vote? They go, no. I said, well, what do they need me for? I don't know.
So we're funding it, but don't have a vote.
Right.
How does that work?
Because we prior boards, and when the New Bourbon Port Authority was established, thought it was in the interest of the city to support the effort, because whatever economic development happens on our doorstep. Not Perryville, not Perry County.
All right, it happens here.
It's in our backyard. And so that was the decision that was made. The county gets represented, because port authorities from the state level are county driven.
What about our audit reports? Were there ever any issues that they brought up?
Who?
As far as the auditor.
About what?
Well, about the way city business is conducted. Right. I mean, our budget process.
Oh, no, there it is. Actually, the process is
happens to me all the time.
Once you've adopted the budget,
I had that one last.
Yeah, well,
they're going to make sure that whatever expenditure we have matches the budget, and that's why we do that kind of multiple budget revisions at the end of the year, is to reconcile expenditures that didn't line up exactly with the line items that were budgeted. We never go over in a department or category, but we make those adjustments kind of among line items.
They're just there to make sure that where we allocate the money, that's where the money's going. Yeah, they're not there to justify if this is right.
No.
And yeah, so no.
We have any further discussion? Joe would like to go home.
And about the medical marijuana situation. No, I'm just kidding.
Thank you.
That was a joke.
So we're gonna take the budget we have. The department heads and I will talk about
tweaks.
What in here could be retained without affecting the service level of the department.
Yes.
We'll reflect those changes in the budget we give you next week.
And we're going to vote on that budget, first reading of it.
Mike,
is that okay? Thank you very much. Joe, you're dismissed.
Thank you, everybody.
I am officially on vacation.
So much.